Hello, so welcome back. Today we're gonna talk a little bit more about filtering. You already know why we need filter signal. You already should check video about how to do few techniques about how to filter signal in the chops. To be honest, it's a lot of different techniques. This is just like pretty common ways to filter signal, but anyway, always it also gonna looks on the data. What kind of data, what kind of noise you have after you need to figure out how to filter it. So basically you always need to do some research and see what's really happening on. So today we're gonna talk a little bit more about the few other techniques. So one of them, you remember last class I showed you the example with leader. So I will show you on this example today again one of the way how to filter signal, but in this case you can filter the signal with even for the chop signal, you still can filter it with the tops, and in some cases it's gonna be much faster, especially if you have like a lot of data. So this is signal that I receive from the my lidar. You remember this small device we use on machine. To track the environment around. So this mostly looks like this. You also have these kind of lidars for Arduino, but they're not scanning the environment around. They're scanning just in front. So it's more like proximity sensors, but much more precise. And it's quite good, to be honest, to use with Arduino. Proximity sensor, ultrasonics have too much noise and too much depends on environment. For now, for this example, I use this one lidar. It's SlamTech 82. It's quite cheap lidar, the cheapest one, A1 for them. It costs like 400-500 RMB. This one I think a little bit more than 1000, and it's have like can cover up to like 16 meter diameter space. For most commercial projects I use this like Hakoya. It's much more expensive, it starts from like 7000, but they a little bit more protective. If I do indoor I still can use this RP lidar, but if I do outdoor I do Hakoya. And in case if it's like really canopy, it's gonna be bad weather or like minus. Hakoya with rain it's fine. Anyway, so all the darts they also quite precise. So for now I use this one for this example, but this lidars does not by default does not support Intage Designer. So I use my custom plugin for this. Hakoya, you just can plug USB or Ethernet cable and it's work, so you don't need to do anything. So that's the data lidar give me. So you see here I can use polar coordinates. First one give me angle and second one give me distance from the center. But in my case I better use Cartesian, it's easy to map, right? So I will attach it to the null. It's quite simple. So if I need to do some math or some processing with the signal, I can do it here. I attach to null. I can do final data. I will rename it to know what is it. And after I can go very easy way, I just can go with the geometry and camera, and I need some material, right, to do. So in geometry, I will replace this one with the simple sphere. I don't need so much details for my sphere. I can do something like this, because pretty much it's gonna be one point and it's gonna be very small. And I will lower down it. Attach to the null. Okay. So for now we can do instancing. We can go to instance and I can apply chop for instance. And after I can see, okay, for XY position I wanna use X, for Y position I wanna use Y. And we not really see much for now. Let's do render. Ah, you see that now it's very big. Data it's sending me it to. It's quite big. So I need to put mask here. And let's just multiply by smaller number, lower that down data from, okay, for now it's okay. And for camera I will change it to the orthographic. So orthographic, it's flat, yeah, it does not apply perspective, it's give me flat image. And now in my transform I can just apply, okay, my camera, okay, I wanna move it more far away. Ah, if I apply for orthographic I need to change here, it's gonna be ortho this. So yeah, so you see, even this simple manipulation, let's camera and background, I will set up alpha to 1 so I can see it clear. This simple manipulation already give me quite good understanding, right, of this data. This data, this signal, this look does not tell me anything. It just tell me, okay, it's scanning because data change. And if I move, I can see, okay, now I move my hand, so here probably this is my hand. Here you can see it much clearer. Okay, this is my hand. Here I have some noise. I have some other devices or some objects that cover it. Okay, not bad. For this one I will just a little bit lower down to have a bit more precision here. Okay, like now it's not bad. And now I have render and now I can do some final result. Alright, I will do out. And this is gonna call final visualization. Let's save it. after I save it, okay, here it's problem because it changed path. Okay. So now it's working, I can see here. Yeah, I can go and I can play with camera. I can adjust my camera again to what I want, how it want to look. Let's do for now how I gonna do it for work. So okay, I doing something like this. I see it's useful and I can reuse it very easily. I don't need to spend every time to set up it. So I wanna build a component. I go here. So this is pretty much I already have a like component, yeah. But now I just wanna customize some this a little bit. So first of all, I just can do customize component, and I can write okay settings. I will add few page and use different parameters. So I go inside here and I can see okay for settings. First of all, for the settings I can set up my parameters for my this parameter. So here I can use bind. If I use bind, it will directly affect. So if you we use reference, so if you see, you see I use bind, it does not matter where I change it, its effect. If I delete it, and yeah, delete it, and if now I apply here and I do like reference, okay, it's now the same because it was changed because I already used bind. So if I do like this, okay, it's changed, but if I do it here, it does not work, right? So that's why always pretty much now I use bind. They introduced just like recently, less than a year ago, this option. So what more things I want to have, I want to just change my COM port from here also. And I want to set up preset here. So now you see, if I go out on this my component, I have additional parameter settings that have these parameters I can change. So if I have multiple leaders, I can just copy this and then not go inside of the network. I can just change COM port. I can enable, disable them the same way, yeah, or I can reset them. Not bad, right? Next one, I can go to the view. And what I want to do for view, I want to set up few parameters. One of them, I want to set up this size for radius. I go here, I bind that master. But I do not want it to have XYZ. I want to just use one float besides one. Okay. And you see now here is error. Because if I go here and open radio, so now by default it's rad X, rad Y, rad this. Now it's just like rad. Yeah, I changed to rad. So it's easy. And you see again, as long as I change it here, in maximum range I want to maybe set up 0.2 so I have more precision here, right, for my size. This one done. So now you see I can now easily from outside will be able to set up this precision. Next things I gonna go and do, I will set up my for camera. I can set up auto width master and range max, let's say 20. Not 20, it's now I have 40, so maybe yeah, let's do 20. So now from outside again I can easily set up my camera position. And for this math I will set up also multiply here as parameter. I will place it to the scale, and you see it's very small number, so I will set up this scale to 0.2, and by default it's gonna be 0.01. Again, now I can easily adjust it, right? So this is all my room. I don't wanna about all my room. All I want is just like what happened around. So this is me. The same I can do with Ortovitz. So this is two parameters. Okay, for Ortovitz, let's set up a little bit bigger range maximum. Let's set up to the 40. Good. So now, okay, this is okay for now. And now for this, I can say okay. Now I have this component where I can set up everything without going inside of my component. So okay, we have this part now, and yeah, last part. Now I want to just select this, save component as docs, and I save it, and now I can use this docs file like here, or I can go to use components, devices, and I can just add this like here. So now next time I just can plug it here and select which LiDAR I want to use or whatever, right? So it's easy. I delete it for now, I don't need, because I have, you see, I have Okakuya, I have for LiDAR, I have component for RailSense, for different MIDI device, for Kinect with tracking. Okay, so this is not bad, but it's still kind of a lot of noise here, right? And how I can get data from this, for example? So one of the way, I can use blob track. But blob track a little bit expensive operation. So before to go to blob track, I will change the resolution. So I will say maybe quarter 1 to 80, and here percent about 180. Okay, now it does not require so much place, and here in blob track you see what it's tracking. So now let's set up this blob track to track me and do not track other objects here. It's not gonna be hard here. So first of all, I can go Ortovitz, and let's do one more thing here for custom parameters. We can set up for you. I wanna set up camera translate and camera rotate. So now you see, if I need some adjustment, I can do it here. And the same for translate rotate. Okay, so this is pretty much position where I want it to be. So this is, I track the surround table. Okay. And blob track, okay, detected. Okay, with three versions, I can track just two maximum elements. Here you see blob track, it give me output of the position UV. So I just will convert it to the chop, and in chop I can output first row is values, first row is names, first column is values. So now I have channel per column. So I have ID to sample, I have UV coordinates, and VX height is inside. So now I can use pretty much UV coordinate to define if it's my object, that I can object trigger something, or in the position I want it to be. But let's do a little bit pre-processing. So first, and one of the simple things, if you do a permanent setup and you have this stuff like here, it's wall, and you wanna get rid of this wall, one simple way to do it, you go, you save the image you have, JPEG, I will save it, you go it, you open Photoshop, you open this image in Photoshop, and I will create just new layer, and I will use black to find this layer. So I can, for example, I know, okay, this is some permanent objects, they're always gonna be there, I don't want them trunk, so I draw this layer. Now I have something like this, I go to file, I save it as PNG with transparency, or I mean, okay, it could be JPEG, but JPEG need less memory. And I will save in the same location with, so I will call it mask. Okay, done, so now I can go and movie file in, I can open this mask again, go to, I can just go it here, it's in the same folder, and now I can use multiply chop, and you see now I pretty much covered this part. Right, so now it's not gonna track here anymore. So and next, now you see a little bit more things here. I have some more things to track. So this I can adjust to the in my parameters. So I can define that my minimum blob size, I wanna be bigger. So now it's gonna track just big areas, right? It's not gonna track this. If I gonna set up it to the small, it can track like anything. So I just set up minimum blob size, I can set up maximum blob size, maximum distance between blobs, delete blobs that too close to each other. So now you see it. Now I have myself and my hand here. I can adjust this to just use one of them. Anyway, here it's a little bit tricky because it's very small space and a lot of object here. So I can check if blob still there. So this is pretty much, and I can call, make another out here. It final blob. We can also try to clean up a little bit more this noise here. How we can do it? Okay, first, for example, I wanna track just the object that moves. Yeah. So in this case, I can go here and write cache. Can apply this to the cache and cache select. So in cache, I wanna set up. Okay, my cache size gonna be 2. And step size, it's in frames, let's say 5 frames. And this one, it's I took like -1, so this one is gonna be a little bit before. Let's do composite here. And in composite, I can apply this to. And I can see add. So you see now it's have kind of delay here, right? But I can use not add, I can use difference. So now it will show me just, now I can calculate the objects that moves. Yeah, the big object that moves. This, for example, me. Okay, this is also triggered, but it's a little bit too much noise. I can try to clean up it with blur. Let's do pre-shrink. Adjust sample step. So here I just get this blur. Like this, not bad. I can do some level. Maybe not brightness here. Okay, again. Because I work with black and white image here, I just can easily convert this image to 8-bit, fix it mono, it's gonna be enough for me. It's also reduced number of channels and it's a little busy to work for me. So now with this I can cut most of the noise here, you see? I just adjust it, okay. And after I can apply this one to the blob here. See now block is just gonna be affected when I move and I does not have much another noise. So it's one of the way to clean up this image. Or let's do like this. I select them and I collapse them and I will call it filter 1 blur. Blur difference. Now let's create another one. Create new, connect here, select, collapse. Go inside and set up to the ground output. This I can delete. So another one, you see, when it's noise like this blinking, okay, this is real object I have in my space. So usually when you will do setup, you does not gonna have so much noise. But if I wanna get rid of the object just like blinking like this, what I can do again, I can go with cache. I can set up cache, and I wanna set up step size, let's say 5, and step size 2 frames between each of them. And after I will go select cache select. One, two, three, four, five. And for this cache select, I will set up minus cache minus one, cache minus two, cache minus three. One, I didn't say minus three, minus four. Minus 5. And after I can use another composite. I will just connect all of them here. And now I see now when I multiply, first of all, the pretty stable, just which one? The one that don't move. But I can use average here. So now if I use average, this one it's gonna be gone. Or I can use even darkened color. So now I can get rid of most of the noise that is just blinking minimum. And I can adjust this cache, maybe like cache step, to get rid of this noise. This one work very well with RealSense usually. If I use RealSense camera, and I have depth image, you see it's a lot of noise. I apply it here, and I can combine the input. And output, okay, output will have a little bit delay, but it's already get rid of a lot of this stuff. I can use blur. Again, to clean up it a little bit. Again, I can have some level here. In this level, I can clean up the what I wanted to detect. Can do like this. So I want to just detect myself. I don't want to detect the ground. Invert. I need to invert it after. And now I can use this as kind of mask here. For video to trigger something. So again, I need to spend much more time for sure to adjust all these parameters. To clean up it here. To get a good result. But this is a way to work. Filter 2, average. So it's pretty much similar like we did in the chops here, like in previous class, when we get the trail and average. So, but this I do on each pixel at the end. Let's save it. So, okay. This is one another way. And you can try basically in compositing a lot of different way here, and you can go and see through them and see what's really will match your purpose the best here. Again, if you wanna just moving objects, you can have multiple of them, you can have minus or multiply, and you will see just like when if you will just multiply, you will have just like objects that static. If you will use exclude or like difference or darker color, you will use just the object that moved. For example, yeah, if you use average, it's kind of like it will help also you to get rid of the noise you have. That's what I need now. So this is one additional way, right, to filter. I will tell you a little bit today also about kernel. What is kernel? You see, we have a lot of filters, usually even here. Okay, let's go out. Okay, this leader. Base. Kernels, and here movie file in, and I want to just go I just want to load some video file here. This is, for example, simulation or an installation, how it's gonna work, how it's gonna move, and we can try to apply some filters for this. And okay, we have few pre-built filters here. Okay, you can use analyze, but analyze just give you some basic information. Yeah, minimum, maximum here, how many pixels, and average, scope, full image, or ROVs. So anti-aliase, so we have anti-aliase, it's just to turn on, turn off anti-aliasing, blur. We talk about blur basically, yeah. You know how to use it already. So I can make my image more blurry. So for again for image recognition or for some computer vision, it's quite good. Good view. We have a chroma key where I can cut out the value. Okay, I wanna just, but you see it's a little bit hard here, right, to work with it, but it still works. I can. That's a little bit noise, more noise here. Again, if environment did not change so much, it could work. And do not forget, so here in the, I think in the image filters, we have convolve here also, already pre-built, yeah. It was chroma here before, but now I do not see in the new version. Maybe in tools. Ah, yeah, in tools. So this one, and it will have oops, I want to just set up it. I want to use input, text background, in red, black. I want to use input here, and here I just can select here what I want to cut out, and I can see the mask, what is the end it's gonna be. So I want to just cut maybe this blue stuff. Crop, you can use a lot also for filtering to clean out some information you don't want to cut it. Cross, depth, difference, that's what we did here. We can get difference between two frames and see where is pixel move, where is some movement happened. Edge detection. Again, you can go and see and try to adjust. So if you need to detect edges here on the image. Embers, it's also can kind of filter where you can detect where is the, it's pretty much similar like edge detection, but it's a little bit different. It looks more like normal map. So now you can apply some functions to this filter also. So for example, I can multiply cosinus, sinus, so, but this is little bit, you need to dig more in the math, yeah, what they're doing. GLSL, that's where most of things are doing, but you will need to write your code here. So this is, we're not gonna cover now, it's for advanced tutorial, advanced classes. Again, you have level, Luma blur, Luma level. So you have some pre-built filters here. If you go to image filters, you can find some filters here. But convolve, it could be interesting for you. Delay could be interesting for you. For the image filtering, at least. Let's check what is convolve, and after I will tell you about kernels, because that's how convolve pretty much work here. You see, this is kernel. Again, you can see how it's work inside. So for convolve, you can set up the wet dry mix. So dry it's original, wet it's output. So you can set up something in the middle. Yeah. So what this is number, this basically is the kernel, it's the filter. So you can get the same result if you will use the convolve top, you apply here, and it will need table for this. I will create table and with dimension like 3x3, for example, and this table I will apply to filter here. So now it's nothing here. Okay. So what this kernel means? Kernel, it means that it's matrix that gonna be multiplied for all pixels, for each pixels. So current pixel is inside here. If I set up it one, it's just the same image that I had before. So for example, so this pixel, one pixel left, one pixel right, one pixel up, one pixel down, and so on. So if I do something like this, I have the same image. If I do something like this, I will have my image move right a bit. So I can do something like this. So I mean, it's pretty much the same, but how to work with these kernels? You can check it here. So this is kind of like very good. So kernels for computer vision, that's how our image looks here. So here we have our grayscale matrix, and you can see the value for each pixel here, right? And we can use, so this is the kernel, we can apply it. So you see, for example, if we want a blur image, we can use this numbers for kernel. Let's try if it's true. So it's gonna be 0625 0125 0625 125 125 125 625 625 and 0.25. So now you see, if I open the original image, you see this is image blurred here. Again, if you gonna calculate sum of this kernels, is gonna be one. It not really must be one. It could be different number, but in this case it will change the brightness and some parameters. Yeah, but it can happen. So different cases. So for example, I can make its kernel a little bit different again. So I can again add some parameters here. 0 1 2 5 0 1 2 5 0 1 2 5 0 1 2 5 0 1 2 5. So now if I gonna do like add more parameters to other pixels here, it's gonna be the first, you see it's make it a little bit brighter and it's more blurry. So you see also kernel could be different weight, yeah, and a different size. It could be 3x5, 3x3, and whatever. So it's not matter. That what we using in convolutional network, neural network, that we talk for artificial intelligence and computer vision. We use these kernels to define some features. So for example, you can see the result, how it's work. So for this pixel, for example, in the middle, you will see in the middle, so this is the current pixel. It's 53 multiplied by 25.25, and we can see all pixels around here, yeah, what the numbers they have and what the output for this kernel. Okay, bottom sobel, it looks like this, -1 -2 -1, and from bottom it's positive and negative. So this one will find the vertical lines on the image, all vertical lines, not vertical, horizontal lines, and mostly where is transition go from white to dark, from the top to bottom. You can see embers. It's kind of like edge detection, similar identity, 0 0, so the center kernel is 1. So it is totally the same image here. Left sobel the same, where transition from left to right, from white to black. Outline, right sobel, how to sharpen image, and top sobel. So I will give this link so you can try this number either here in this table, or you can set up them in this convolve. So for example, for this one I also can do 0, 6 to 5, 1 to 5, 6 to 5, 1 to 5, 2 5, 1 to 5, 6 to 5, 1 to 5, 2 5, 1 to 5, 6 to 5, 1 to 5, 1 to 5, 1 to 5. And now you see the same like original image and blurry image. So you can use either convolve or either this table and convolve top to try out different kernels here. You can also try here, yeah, you see in the browser. You can try some parameters and see how it's changed the image. Here again, this, so it's, you can find some multiple, so this is blur, sharpen, how to make image more sharp, dark, lighter, edge, I don't know, Mike's favorite, what this mean, it's recognize clouds, it's like HDR and custom, whatever. Then you can see different images again. Here's some explanation. So again, on Wikipedia you can see different filters like Gaussian blur, how like do on sharp mask, yeah, how to do image more sharp. More sharp for the small details. This is sharp and it just like will sharp everything, and sharp mask it will make sharper just details, not the main parts. And yeah, you can even do like motion blur. So yeah, this is another article I will post. It's how to do image filtering for color pollution. It has some code in Python also. You can, it's not Python, it's GLSL. You can ignore the code. You can just see how it works. So you just can see this matrix. This means filters 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. So you can, again, try to apply them. Another blur filter, bigger blur filter. You have kernel 5x5 matrix here. Gaussian blur, smaller, bigger. Some another filter, so motion blur filter. So you can make motion blur for your image if you want. I don't know, if you do some like 3D rendering and you wanna some add some motion blur, you can apply this. It's kind of interesting techniques also, without using feedback, and get some a little bit more interesting results. So this is, you'll find edges based on color. Another filter, find edges again. So you, how to do like sharpen image, not so sharp, super sharp, so for this article basically what you could be interesting, just you can read and try to understand code. But I think most of the things you need to care now is just like this is edges and filters. So you can try out and see how and where you can try to use them and apply. So this is pretty much all for now. So what we learned today, first of things we learned that even if you have chops, sometimes it's easier to convert this chop signal to the visual image so you can see by yourself what happened around, and it's easy to work with data this way, and after you can apply some filters for it. You still can do filtering here, but again on GPU, on TOPS, it will be faster, more efficient if you have a lot of data, and it's more visually better for you, like it's easy to understand what happened here. So we use render to render points. We figure out today how to build our own components you can reuse after, how to use blob detection to detect some objects on our image, how to clean out static noise like static elements, walls, doors, tables or whatever, what you don't want to detect for your installation. We tried two simple filter techniques, blur and distance, blur and difference, right, for example, and average, so when you where you can get the more stable data without the noise, because again still all of sensors they have noise at the end. And I give you a very fast overview for kernel. So I want to go a little bit deeper in kernels. I want you read this one. It's very small, very short. It have examples. You can try here different kernels, try how it works. And that's all for today. See you next time.